بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم أخرجني من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمني بنور الفهم. اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. We started the discussion about امتناع أو إعادة المعدوم. That is the last lesson in the third section of the book. امتناع أو إعادة المعدوم. The last lesson in third section. In the original Farsi is lesson 11, but in English I think it's nine.
It must be a restoration.
Yes. Sorry. Yes. I already gave you a brief introduction to this lesson. The Assalamu alaikum. The main point is here. If something exists and then is destroyed or no longer existence is given to it, so basically it stops to exist, can the same thing become restored? Can we bring it back? Or even if we have another thing very, very similar to it, it would not be the same thing. The reason this discussion came into the books on theology and philosophy was because some Muslim theologians, some mutakallimun, they thought that resurrection is a case of restoration of what used to exist. And therefore they wanted to discuss this. They thought that when something like a human being dies and then is resurrected on the Day of Judgment, it's like i'adatul ma'dum, something which existed, then it has stopped to exist, then it is brought back to existence. Therefore, they try to prove that this is possible, because they wanted to defend resurrection. But Muslim philosophers, especially, you know, people like Ibn Sina, they said, first of all, resurrection is not a matter of i'adatul ma'dum. It's not that when we die, we stop to exist and then we are brought back to existence. We exist all the time. Even when we die, we exist. Just our body departs from the soul, and then again, body is resurrected. Otherwise, soul always exists. Secondly, so the first is that ma'ad or resurrection is not a kind of i'adatul ma'dum, restoration of what used to exist. Second point is that this is impossible to restore something that used to exist. Actually, Ibn Sina said it is something that doesn't need proof. Even if you can imagine, you can conceive, you can understand what is the question, what does i'adatul ma'dum mean, then you would yourself say this is impossible. There is no need to bring proofs and, you know, arguments. It's self-evident. But in order to make it very, very clear and, you know, explain things further, they have also mentioned some arguments, which we can say these are like reminder, like awakening and knowledge that you already have. Before I mention the arguments, I would like to refer to something which is on page 106 about the difference between restoration of something exactly as it was or used to be, or creating something similar, and then you may, you know, a little bit, you know, exaggerate and say this is the same thing. These are two things. Sometimes it's really the same thing, which is impossible. Sometimes it's another thing from the same type, and you carelessly or, you know, roughly, you say this is the same. For example, imagine if you have some money in your pocket and then you are robbed. You manage to find the robber, you report to the police, and the police ask him to give that money back to you. For example, you lost 100 pounds and then you get 100 pounds. You say, I've got my money back. It's the same money. But indeed, for you here to be the same is not a matter of philosophically the same. Maybe it's another money. It's just enough for you that it has the same value. Maybe the notes are changed. You know, you say it's the same money. Why? Because here for you, as I said, similarity in value is important. 100 pounds, this is also 100 pounds. But sometimes similarity in type is not enough. It has to be exactly the same. For example, Salam alaikum. If, God forbid, you lose your child or little brother or little sister, and then you find or they give you another child similar in age and gender, here you don't say, I was given back my child or my, you know, brother or sister. Because here, identity is very important. So in the case of money, identity of money was not important, just the value was important. So you say, I was given my money back. But here you see, you cannot say it's the same thing. So when we say, e'adatul ma'adum bi'ayneh, restoration of what used to exist in a very exact and similar, you know, identical way, here, to be similar in type is not sufficient. It has to be exactly the same thing. Okay, now let's mention the arguments. Of course, as I said, these arguments might be for some people arguments, and for some people just can be reminder. The first thing is this. Can there be a distance, a gap between something and itself? No. You know, between two things, there can be gap. For example, between me and this book, there is a gap. Even if I touch the book, there is a gap. We are not the same. We are not exactly connected. Or sometimes there's a gap in time. For example, between a person who lives now and a person who lived 100 years ago. There's a gap. So it's possible that two things have a distance between them. But there cannot be distance between something and itself. If we accept the possibility of i'adatul ma'dum, restoration of what used to exist, it means that we are accepting that between something and the same thing, there can be a gap, there can be a distance. A existed up to, for example, yesterday. Now, tomorrow, we want to bring it back. It's not possible. Why? Because it means that there is a gap between A and the same A. How can something be separated from itself? How can something be before itself or something be after itself? It's not possible. If you have one continuous being, like for example, each of us, we came to this world, for example, 30 years old ago, 40, 50, 60, whatever, years ago. And we are carrying on. Because there has been no gap, we can say this is the same being, the same reality which is going through different stages. But if something totally stops to exist, and then after some gap or interval, there is a being which looks similar, we don't say they are the same. They are not the same because there is a gap between something and itself. The second argument that might be clearer than other arguments, and it's based on asalatul wujud, primordiality of existence, is this. When you believe in asalatul wujud, so the reality of the things is coming from their existence. If you believe in asalatul mahiyya, then you can say the reality of things is based on their mahiyya, and mahiyya is there even if they don't exist. You know, mahiyya by itself doesn't require to exist. المهيه من حيث هي ليست الا هي لا موجوده ولا معدومه. Mahiyya as such doesn't imply existence or non-existence. It's equal. So mahiyya can be just something in our mind, doesn't need to have reality. Okay, so when it has existence or non-existence, you may say it's the same thing. For example, Zayd as a person, as a human being, you can say Zayd existed, then didn't exist, then existed again, but it's a Zayd, because you are concerning with Mahiyya. But according to Asalatul Wujud, the reality is Wujud. And Zayd is real and is Zayd when it exists. If Zayd doesn't exist, it's not Zayd. So how can then Zayd, whose reality is existence, be the same Zayd after it stops to exist? Every existence is a reality. So you cannot take these two instances of existence as identical. In other words, please listen carefully to this point. Alhamdulillah, you know Arabic, so you know what is the difference between wujud and ijad. What is the difference between wujud and ijad?
To create.
Yeah. Wujud is Esma Mastar, is the result for Ijad. Ijad means to give existence, to create, to originate, to bring into existence. Every wujud needs an act of ijad. Okay, except wajibul wujud. Wajibul wujud is not in need of ijad. But all contingent beings, they can only exist if they are brought into existence. There must be ijad. If you study this very well and carefully, you realize that indeed ijad and wujud are like, not exactly, but are like two sides of the same coin. When you look at the agent or the creator, the originator, you say ijad. Then you look at it from the other side, you say wujud. Okay? Like khalq. When you look at creator, you say khalq. When you look at the other side, you have also makhluq, which is the same thing which has been created. So every ijad and every wujud are two sides of the same coin. Ijad in time A and ijad in time B are two different ijads. And therefore, the other sides of their coin would be also different. Ijad A gives wujud A, ijad B gives wujud B. Okay? Maybe this example is good, I don't know. If it is not good, don't get angry with me. You know, if, for example, there is light, and I bring my hand and I create a shadow. This is the maximum people like me can do, just to create shadow. You cannot do anything more. Okay, I create a shadow. Okay? When I, in for example, at 8 o'clock in the morning, when there is sunshine, I bring my hand and I create shadow. This shadow and this movement of my hand cannot be separable from each other. Then I stop at 2 p.m. Again, I bring my hand the same place and create similar shadow. Then you cannot say these two shadows are the same because they're created by the same person, the same hand. These are two different shadows because two different initiation of shadow. Pardon? Same time next day also can be, yes. Yeah. Or somehow the same lengths, but two different times. Next day, most, for example. Or next year, the same day. So you didn't get angry with my example? Yeah. Intention?
Yeah, because each time I make the shadow, I make intention to make shadow. And next time I'll make again.
For shadow, you don't need intention. It's tabassoli, not ta'abudi.
This is a natural shadow, but like if I make like this, I make purposely. So this means I have intention to make this type of things. Unconsciously.
No, even if you do it unintentionally, you create shadow.
Yeah.
Sometimes, for example.
At night, no.
Pardon?
Not at night.
Yes, in night, no. In night, even with intention, you cannot do it. Yeah. Okay. Now we move to the third argument.
I just have one question about
yes.
At eight o'clock, the shadow of my hand. At 1 minute after.
You have moved your hand. You kept your hand.
Doesn't matter.
It matters.
After 1 minute.
It matters. If you have not moved your hand, we can say it's the same shadow. But if you moved your hand and then bring it back, it's not the same shadow.
We can't say that it's not the same shadow on the basis.
You know, a student who has always been coming to the hose and the one who stops and registers again, they are not the same. This is why we have to admit again if someone doesn't come and then wants to come again. Yes. Yeah. Sure.
Then on that basis, every second, every instance, there's ijad for that instance.
Yeah, but you consider these seconds separate. Otherwise, time is not just dots put next to each other. You know, when we were learning, maybe in primary school, they used to tell us, for example, perhaps, that if you want to have a line, just you put dots. But line is not dots. You imagine dots. Otherwise, even if you have millions of dots, it doesn't make a line. Okay? If you have millions of points in time, it doesn't become time. Time has to be without a stop. You know, there are two types of clocks. One of them for the second, you know, it stops, it moves, it stops. Some goes continuously. This one is more closer to the reality of time that goes continuously.
So, Shema, it would be correct to say it is one ijab, but spread out on this time?
No. It's one continuous ijad. It is our analysis that can say this is thousands of ijad, but in reality it's one ijad. And this is why, you know, we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't make many, many acts of creation. He only created once and one thing. Ma amruna illa wahida. We analyze it and divide it into a smaller parts, into different times. Otherwise, Allah only did one action. And that action is for us unfolding. We analyze it. Okay, the third argument. The third argument is using the concept of motion and time. Question? Okay. Motion and time. If you move your hand, for example, from right to the left, horizontally, from right to the left, this motion happens in a certain, in particular time. For example, it takes a few seconds. And if you stop and then again move your hand from the same place to the same destination. So twice from right to left, from same place you start, and in the same place you stop, the same time, I mean the same duration, but time is different. Can we say these two motions are the same? No. They are not the same.
They can be parallel?
They can be parallel if two motions take place at the same time, or like now, one comes after the other, but they are not the same motion. Yes, there are similarities. You can say it's similar. They are similar. Why? Because they started from the same place, ended in the same place. But these are two the advantage of this argument is that uses the concept of time and tries to explain that you cannot think time is just something imaginary or something which is not important. You know, time is not like, for example, you say, my book is the same whether I bring it to this room or another room. This room is just a container. I bring my book to this room or another room. Then you say, I bring this motion to this time or another time. I say, no. motion in this time is different from motion another time. Because time is not separable from something. When something is gradual, time is part of it. You know, there are people who say time is the fourth dimension. According to Mullah Sadra, this is very easy to prove. That everything which has substantial motion, then time is part of its reality. Yes. Time should be with motion. If there is no motion, there is no time. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no time. Or according to philosophers, angels have no time because they have no motion. We call them mujarrad tam. There is no change in them.
Angels come down and they go up. They descend down to give the revelation to the prophet and go up. They have a motion.
In the past, they thought that the sun is going around us. But now we know that we are going around sun. So now we think angels come and go, but in reality we are changing our position. Pardon?
You mean the prophet could have gone up instead of the angels coming down?
No, prophet does his own thing. But just I'm saying that whenever you attribute a change to Allah or to the angels, this change is in our imagination. Otherwise, we have changed. They have not changed. Okay.
I mean, clearly in the Quran, tatanazzal, so it's moving.
Yeah, like you can say, sun is shining on me now, sun is not shining on me in the night. The light of sun is coming to you in the day, not in the night. But sun is not changing. You are changing.
Pardon? It's not the same. Because even about the sun, Allah is saying that it is moving. But in Shams wal Qamar Yajriyan.
No, that's another issue. I am saying suppose.
I mean,
suppose sun is not moving, but still we see it moving. Why? Even, you know, now, although we know sun is not moving and, you know, earth is moving around sun, but all the calculations based on the old astronomy still is valid. And still they make calculation based on assuming sun, earth is the center of the world for the calculations. When they want to calculate moon eclipse or, you know, calendar, they assume that sun is the center. So this is a matter of reference, your point of reference. You can say we are changing, or you can say sun is changing. What is important is that the relation between us and sun is certainly changing. Okay?
In real terms,
yes.
How do you explain the angels and our relation?
Prophet's relation with whom? So, as I said, according to philosophers, because mutakallimin have different ideas, but according to most of philosophers, angels are mujarrad tam. There is no change in them. Okay? There is no change in them. Therefore, if there is any text that suggests angels change, you have to interpret it in a different way. Like, for example, if there is a text that suggests that Allah is changing. You remember when we talked about Sifat al-Fi'l? He said you have to interpret it in the way that doesn't suggest that Allah is changing. عَلِمَ أَن سَيَّكُونُ مِنْكُمْ مَرْضَى. You have to interpret it as Sifat al-Fi'l, not Sifat al-Zat. Because ilm al-Zati doesn't change. So, those who believe that angels are perfect, abstract beings. Therefore, anything that suggests that angels change, they interpret it as a change in the relation. Of course, this is not maybe necessary for you at this stage to, you know, digest. But just keep it in your mind so that you know the world is greater than what we think. Yes.
Then the angels are coming down to the Arabic word says it. So how do we interpret that? Help us with that, please.
So again, it's a matter of relation. When you say, for example, mercy of God came down to me, what does it mean? Does it mean that something has left Allah and come to us? Even in the Quran, you know, we explain this. When Allah sent down the Quran, we said the Quran has not left Allah, has not departed from that world. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ لَدَيْنَا لَعَلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. So, for example, just as an example, one meaning of some people, angels come down to them, like for example, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. Those who say our Lord is Allah and they remain persistent, angels come down to them and say, don't fear and don't grieve. So one meaning of this can be that they rise to the level that they can have conversation. تَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. But it means that they are rising over other human beings, and therefore they can be spoken by the angels. Yes. Pardon? According to those philosophers, none of this is movement in its real sense. I'm not saying that is what we have to accept. I'm saying this is the way that normally philosophers like Allama Tabatabai, you know, Ayatollah Jawadi Amoli, this type of people, they take angels to be mujarradatan. But also they take angels to be ma'soom. They don't accept the story of Petros. Okay? They don't accept that. So everything has to be interpreted according to these principles. But mutakallamun have different ideas. You know, many mutakallamun, especially people who follow more the literal meanings of the hadith, they say no, angels also can change. Angels can commit, you know, mistakes. So there are different opinions, and this is the beauty of Islam, that you have among scholars different views. But it has to be among scholars, not among non-scholars. Okay? You study 30, 40 years, then you can say, I think. Not I believe, you know, I think this can be, you know, Islamic position. But not that everyone takes the courage of saying, this is Islam, this is not Islam. Yes?
Angels being Mujarrad al-Tam, is that in relation to dunya in this world or in totality?
In totality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wajib. So among mumkinat, then we have jawhar and araz. Among jawahir, we have five types. One is ughul, which means mujarradata. Allah is above this, you know, division between substance and araz.
This is in relation to us,
to contingent beings. But if you mean by mujarrad anything which is not material, then you can say Allah is also mujarrad. But if you mean by mujarrad a contingent being which is not material, then we don't use it for Allah.
Second question. Doesn't
Allah believe in qudum zamani, not zati? Most of Muslim philosophers believe that alam is not preceded by a time. So it's not that there was a time that this world didn't exist. Because mutakallimin say alam is hadith, means has a history of non-existence. But philosophers say no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is fayyaz ala al-itlaq. He is absolutely gracious and generous. So always something existent. And we say always, not necessarily meaning time. It means when whatever you can imagine as a time, as a point of reference, is always filled with creation. But when you are talking about this material, physical world, yes, this can have a lifetime, but not preceded by time. You cannot say there was a time that this world didn't exist. If this world didn't exist, there was no time. But then we have mujarradat, who existed even before time existed. Okay?
So in relation to our point about motion and time, this motion and time relates to this world. It's not the absolute.
Yeah, because motion is for material world.
So that ayah in Quran that Allah says that I created in 7 days. So that is for the material world.
Yes, samawati wal ard. This is for this world.
What about hattat fihi min malaik?
This relation is not physical relation. It's not that physically angels are here, you know, and you can take to a lab or a scan or X-ray. Yeah, this is not physical relation. For example, yadullah fawqa aydihim. What does it mean? Okay, no problem. Yeah, but doesn't mean that malaika have a physical location.
Why not, Sheikh? They are bodies at the end.
No, they are not physical bodies. No, they are not physical.
Okay, but I mean, they are nurani, but they are bodies.
They are mujarrad. They don't occupy any space. Angels don't occupy any space. Therefore, even if you have millions of angels in this room, there is no crowd. Human beings make, you know, things crowded, but angels don't make anything crowded. In, what does it mean to be in heaven and here in this in? They have no physical space, so you cannot limit them by physical space. No problem. What's the problem? There are many angels, but I'm saying they don't occupy a space. Therefore, even if there are thousands of them, they are not taking, it's not that each of them take part of the space, so there would be a crowd. They don't occupy space, therefore they don't conflict. Okay? They don't conflict.
So a spiritual body to be like that is what?
If you have 10 pious scholars in a town, they also don't conflict each other. If they are not pious, even two of them have no space. because they're material.
Mm-hmm.
For sure, that sajda is not, you know, they took torba and they, you know, because they don't have head, they don't, you know, put, you know, ground. That sajda is acknowledgement of respect for Adam. Yes.
Our spiritual aspect.
Yes.
Is that an abstract existence?
What?
Is that an abstract origin? Our origin from God.
Okay.
That was blown into us. Is that an abstract creation?
According to Mullah Sadra, we said ruh jismaniyatul huduth ruhaniyatul baqa. So we said Mullah Sadra says that ruh comes in the process of evolution and development of body of embryo. At a certain point when body grows, then ruh comes into existence. Thumma ansha'nahu khalqan akhar. Ruh was not before. According to Ibn Sina, yes, but according to Ibn Sina, maybe. Even Ibn Sina, maybe. But according to Mullah Sadra, no. Even I told you, Ayatollah Mutahhari says that the same meat and bread that mother, for example, father eat, becomes a child and becomes the ruh.
Yes, but then they are not abstract in that case. Our ruh is not abstract.
In the beginning, no. But when ruh is created, it's abstract, but not fully abstract. This is nafs, not aql. So our nafs is partially mujarrad. Mujarradun zatan. But in action is material. So our soul is in between. It's on the edge of the physical world and the spiritual world. Human soul is in between. Has some connection with the spiritual world and some connection with the physical world. So this is actually why we can become better, and because we are not put into the world of abstracts by creation. You are in the middle. If you manage to move on to that side, you are better than the people who are put in that side. Yeah? So, if you are born into a family of ulama and you become alim, it's good. But someone who has no alim in family and moves to that is better. Yeah? If you are born in Qom and you study, it's good. But if you're from another part of the world, you go to Qom and study, it's different. So we are not born into the world of angels, but if we ascend and reach that world, we are better. And if we descend and go to the world of animals, then we are worse than animals. Because we were in a higher position, then we went down. So it's up to us. First in what?
On start of existence.
Of course, first, soul is not there. Soul is about 120 days, you know, something like that.
And was another question that was one of the examples could be also, for example, between yesterday and today, our body is changing. We do not notice and do not see.
Yeah.
It's different from yesterday.
But it's the same body.
Yeah, the same body, but with the
because
time,
of continuity.
Yeah, the time is different.
No problem. We said a human being can live 20 years, 30 years, 50 years, but it's the same person. Yeah. This continuity is important. But if it doesn't exist, and then again it's coming to exist, and they are not the same thing.
When they die, still happen the same? Or
yes, even when you die, you exist. In Barzakh, still there are some changes. Still some changes, but not changes in, for example, your body. It's not that your hair becomes white, or for example, your skin, for example. Pardon? No, it's not a matter of bodily, because this body is left. So you have barzakhi body. So you are not affected by time. You are not, you know, for example, losing weight or putting on weight. But your soul can change. For example, your suffering in barzakh can affect you, or your pleasure in barzakh can affect you. Yes.
What about this ayah in reverse in the Quran? وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَلَائِكَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ يَمْشُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَبَسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ الْأَمْرَ. الإمام الحسن عليه السلام, he said to one Shaykh, وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَأَرَيْنَاكُمْ زَغَبَ جَنَاح جَبْرَائِيلَ فِي بُيُوتِنَا. And what about the wings?
These are what we call tamathul. Sometimes an angel takes the form of a material, physical, worldly object. For example, an angel can appear to Lady Maryam as a human being. Tamathala laha basharan sawiya. An angel can take the form of a bird. You can see a pigeon. But this pigeon can be an angel. No. They are not changing. Your understanding is changing. Yeah. Yes. Of course. Yeah. You know, a philosopher understands from what Imam says something different.
Yes.
Father? Yes. So, angel is not a human being or a bird. But in your understanding, it can appear as an angel or a bird. And this is called tamathul. فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا
Yeah. Actually, Sheikh, there are even some Muslim philosophers or people who have studied philosophy, for example. They are saying, for example, that all the verses about hell and paradise in the Quran, it's not physical hell and not physical paradise. And they are, of course, going from the philosophical understanding. In that case, you know, many things which are thawabit becoming just somehow not there, you know, because of this kind of
No. It depends. If something is very well established as a religious doctrine, like Ma'ad Jismani, because the zawahir of the Quran and hadith about corporeal resurrection are so many that no one can say they are used metaphorically, then even philosophers have tried to keep it. But if something is philosophically proved to be impossible, then you can revisit those verses and find a meaning which would not be contradicting those principles. Of course, these are all out of 100% faith in the Quran. Not that they don't have faith in the Quran, but this is the way they understand things. Every person should have this, what we call al-iltizamul ijmal. As a whole, you have to say, I believe in whatever Allah revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I believe in whatever the Prophet taught. Whether it was the way that Mullah Sadra says, or Ibn Sina says, or Ibn Arabi says, you don't need to make all these detailed decisions. Okay? Inshallah, when you study and you yourself become established scholar, then you may develop some opinions. right now what is important is you make sure that you have this al-tazamul ijmali, means as a whole, you believe in everything that was revealed by Allah to the Prophet. And many of these things may not affect your understanding of religion or your understanding of God. Because the main thing is that we know that we are first created. We are not, you know, wajibul wujud, or we are not just result of explosion. We are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is the most perfect, the best, the purest, the most merciful, the most kind, and we should get closer to Him, and that is coming by always increasing your understanding, increasing your love, and trying to remain humble and get rid of your arrogance. These are few important things that whether you are a philosopher or arif or faqih or lay person, you understand and you have to do it. Yes. And none of these academic scholarly discussions should make us forget our relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the main question. Okay, the next issue is mental existence. Wujud al-dhahni in Farsi, or al-wujud al-dhahni. You know, one of the discussions you find in Bidayatul Hikmah or Nihayatul Hikmah by Allama Tabatabai is al-wujud imma dhahniyun wa imma kharijiyun. Existence is either mental or external. Of course, the philosophers at the same time say all types of existence are khariji, are external. Then a question comes, if all types of wujud is khariji, then why you say wujud is either zihni or khariji? Pardon?
This conception, the brain.
Yeah.
Same thing.
So, so how you can say wujud is always khariji and at the same time you say wujud is either zihni or khariji? Yeah, that, inshallah we explain this gradually. Basically, this is a very important aspect of Islamic theory of knowledge. Muslim philosophers in different discussions have addressed the issue of knowledge, understanding. One of it is the discussion about wujud al-dhahni. Another discussion which is very important is ittihad al-aql wal-aql wal-ma'qul, which is the unity between the intellect and the intellected, and aql means the one who understands. Aql means the intellect, and ma'qul means what is understood. So in that discussion also they discuss about this. Also in some discussions about nafs, they talk about ilm. Anyway, this is one discussion about ilm which is very important. And as you know, the title of section 4 is Idrak, is about understanding, about knowledge. So what they mean is sometimes we have knowledge of something that is immediate and direct. Do you remember al-ilm al-huduri and ilm al-husuli? Yeah, we had it before. In ilm al-huduri, knowledge by presence, I have some understanding of myself and faculties of my soul, and you know, conditions like happiness, fear, joy, hope, despair. You know, when you feel happy, how do you understand this happiness? You understand it directly and immediately. You don't use concepts. When you say, I am happy, this is ilm husuli. This is conceptual knowledge. And it can be mistaken. But the very feeling that you have of happiness, which can only exist at the same time that you have that happiness, that is knowledge by presence. Therefore, we say, al-ilmu qisman, knowledge is one of the two. Al-ilmu al-huduri wa huwa hudurul ma'lum ladal alim. What is known is present for the knower. Your knowledge of yourself. You know, you have an understanding of yourself. That is direct. Because you are present for yourself. Your happiness is present for you. We have also al-ilmu al-husuli wa huwa huzur surat al-ma'lum lad al-alim. Not huzur al-ma'lum lad al-alim. The mental image of the known is present for the knower. When you say, I exist, I am happy, you are standing, you are sitting, these are all husuli. You use concepts, then you can make sentences, you can ask questions, but it's all indirect. Our knowledge of each other is always husuli. Because whether you notice or not, we don't have direct understanding of each other. I have an image of you or millions of images of you. And those images, if they correspond to the reality which is you, then I have true knowledge. Otherwise, it's jahl. For example, if someone is not here and I see someone is here in my mind, there's a mistake. Or if, for example, someone is sitting, I believe that he's standing. This mistake. If what is in my mind corresponds to the reality, then that's ilm. But this is done so beautifully that you don't notice. You know, like for example, if there is a very, very good TV, big screen, you know, like real size screen. If there's a real size screen, three-dimensional, then you may think that you are seeing the reality, but it's not the reality. You shouldn't think that you are seeing the reality. Okay? Or if you see something in mirror, you shouldn't think that you are seeing it. No, you are seeing a reflection of it, an image of it. So we always see images of the things which are outside. Even we can have understanding of ourselves through images. Like, I am happy. It means that you have created an image of yourself and happiness and put it together and made a sentence. Okay? So, wujud al-dhahni or mental existence is when you have an image in your mind which reflects a reality that may exist or may not exist, but that reality has a mahiyah, has essence. And through this image, you understand that essence. For example, you have an image of a horse. You have an image of a flower, image of a human being. That can exist, therefore this image corresponds. Maybe that doesn't exist, but you have that image in your mind. So that image does not necessarily mean that something exists outside you. It can exist outside you, or it can just be in your mind. But what is important? if that thing exists in the external world, that image is the connection, is the link for you to get to the external world. Okay? So you can say, I understood what is in the real world. I know this man. I know this person, this object. How do you know it? Through this image. So this image has two aspects. From one aspect is an image for you, created by you. It's a quality of your soul. It's aras, as an accident for you. And from this aspect, it is not wujud zehni. This by itself, a wujud khariji. Because sometimes wujud khariji is in your own mind. From the other aspect, it is wujud zehni. And when it's reflecting, like, you know, a mirror. A mirror is called a mirror from the reflective aspect of it. Otherwise, it can be a glass. Yeah, a mirror can be a glass, not mirror. So these images in our mind, from one aspect, they are beings which are part of our soul, and they are khariji, they are real. But they have the possibility or capability of reflecting real things. And from that side, we call them wujud zehni. If you have a flower in your mind, that is not a real flower. But at the same time, that can reflect the real flower. Yeah? If you have fire in your mind, that is not real fire. Therefore, it doesn't burn you. Yeah? But it can reflect real fire. Real fire only exists in outside. But this image can correspond to that. So you can say, this is really fire. I know fire. Yes, you know fire. But you are aware of fire through something which reflects fire and is not fire in existence. Existentially is not fire. Conceptually it's fire. Is it clear? Wujud zehni and wujud khariji. Al wujud zehni, al wujud khariji. So this is very important discussion. And there are then questions that inshallah we can address. For example, whether this wujud zehni belongs to one category or two categories. Because someone says, okay, because it's a human being or a horse, should be haywana nate or haywana sahel, but because it's a mental image, should be an aras. Aras, accident, a quality, kayfa nafsani. So some people say then it belongs to two qualities. They know. Existentially, it's kayfa nafsani. But from a reflective side, it is either a human being or a horse, but not really, just reflecting. Okay, it's better if I stop here, because if I continue, maybe it becomes too much for you. But please try to study in advance the objections which are mentioned, because there are few objections and answers to them and different responses, you know, so you need to, inshallah, prepare yourself for the next session. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Yes. Yes.
Is that or combination?